Hi, I'm Jewel, and you're watching Stingray Pause Play.
I'm Zach Monson, and welcome back to a very special edition of Stingray Pause Play here in the Stingray offices, doing our very first remote interview with a person who you already know. Jewel, how are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm so good. I'm so glad to have you back as our kind of first remote interview. I'm just thrilled, and you've brought such a strong hat with you, and I really appreciate that.
You know, for you, the strong hat.
Thank you so much. Starting music off so young, I'm sure you have many answers to this question, but I often like to start off the interview with a question of, what is your fondest childhood musical memory?
My fondest childhood musical memory is singing with my mom and dad in Inuit villages in Alaska. My mom and dad were professional singers, and we sang in hotels for tourists in Anchorage. But during the summer, we would go up into the Arctic and tour villages. And I have so many memories, from being picked up in dog sleds to the warmth and the hospitality of each village, that felt, you know, this hosting duty obligation to perform for us again. So every time we put on a show, they put on a show for us. Just, it was an amazing experience.
Growing up in Homer, Alaska, there are so many things that are very Alaskan. I'm only recently, and this is thanks to you, discovering moose poo earrings and jewelry. So thank you to opening my eyes to that. What is your favorite thing that you would consider to be very Alaskan?
I first of all want you to know, I feel like I should make a public proclamation, because, you know, shame loves the darkness. I was an entrepreneur when I was young.
Oh, no. Well, that's it for the interview, Julia.
My 11-year-old hustle was making moose poop jewelry. So that's what you're looking at right here.
Wow. That's really special. Okay. So your favorite Alaskan thing, are we sticking with moose poop jewelry, or is there another thing that's very Alaskan that you love?
I think a thing that's very Alaskan are the women, the attitude of women, the pioneer state. You know, I was raised with six aunts, my dad and his one brother, and all my aunts, you know, they were all pioneers. They were the first sort of settlers in Alaska. And so I wasn't raised with gender roles. And I didn't know that was special. I didn't even know it was a thing until I came down to the States, where women cook and they clean and they have a really specific job, and men have another job. My older brother did all the cooking. He liked being inside. My dad was hard to work with, and I didn't mind the confrontation because I loved working cattle and horses and building fences. And I learned to think and do things for myself, and that I was self-reliant. I learned that I was every bit as capable, not as strong, but I was always expected to figure it out. And you did. So that, to me, is very Alaskan and something I'm really proud of.
We asked the last artist that we had in to ask you a question. The artist is Elijah Woods and Jamie Fine. And their question for you is...
What's up? We're Elijah Woods, ex-Jamie Fine.
And our question for you is, if you could only have 5 ingredients to put in a smoothie, what would they be?
You're welcome, Jewel.
Oh, very interesting. I would do avocado, protein powder, cucumber, carrot, half an apple.
Wow. Okay. So only a little bit of fruit. See, I would have gone 5 fruits, but that's just me.
Yeah. I'm a vegetable. I call it my dirt smoothie.
Having written so many songs in your life, whether unreleased or not, what do you remember about the experience of you writing for the first time? You know, because there's one thing about performing, right? You're performing with your family. That's a whole other thing than wanting to put your thoughts to paper musically. Do you remember about that first experience for you and where you were in your life, what was going on in your head and what you wrote about?
Yeah. I moved out when I was 15. I was young, and I started paying rent. And then I was cleaning buildings, and a dance teacher came from a school in the States, an art school, and he found out I could sing. And so he helped me apply for a scholarship, and I got a partial scholarship. And then I did my first little solo show of cover songs. It was Cole Porter songs, because there was a gay man in me dying to get out. And they helped me raise the rest of the money. They helped me raise $10,000 to go to this fancy, fancy school.
Wow.
So I showed up there, you know, with a large hunting knife, and almost got kicked out my first day, because apparently that's not smiled upon in finer establishments. But very Alaskan. You couldn't stay on campus for the spring breaks. And I was on my own. I didn't have any money to get home. And so I decided my version of lemonade was to hitchhike across the country, learn guitar so that I could street sing, and then go hitchhike through Mexico because I'm super smart. And my first stop was Chicago. Ran out of money. That was like the money I had got me to Chicago. And so I just started making up lyrics as people walked by. And it was my first time seeing the States and pop culture and just, you know, a different thing than I was raised with. And that turned into Who'll Save Your Soul.
Wow.
I just wrote that song for 2 weeks. It had 3,000 verses, and working on those lyrics was, you know, that changed my life.
And is that a strange feeling for you, knowing that the first song really you wrote is a song that really was so impactful on your entire career? That's, I don't think that happens too often, right? You kind of have to get into it a little bit and screw up and be really bad at it. But that song's not bad at all, Jewel.
Yeah, it was a trip. You know, I got signed 3 years later, homeless, no intention of getting signed. I was just trying to make rent and get out of my car. At first, I remember really panicking because I didn't know how to write a hit. I never meant to write a hit. It was a complete accident. It was just an exploration of curiosity. But then I realized that record went on to sell so many. Like, I started selling a million albums every single month for over a year.
Holy
and I had
cow.
A really big back end on my deal. And so I basically just made a crap ton of money. And I realized I can either look at this as the most pressure in the world, or I can look at it as I just won the lotto.
Right.
And there's no pressure. I never have to have a hit again. It doesn't matter. And so I chose the latter, and I just decided cut myself a break, basically, and just have fun creatively the rest of my life. And I've been able to do that.
What an amazing gift you get to give yourself. Like, I don't think many people have that. And that's a wonderful. I think you've done so many great things with your time, truly. And as we look back and Pieces of You, the album, is now here 25 years old. Does it feel like it's 25 years old?
Yeah, it feels like 5 minutes underwater.
Yeah, right.
In some ways, it feels very, very fast. In other ways, it feels like I've lived 12 lifetimes.
With this new 4-disc, although I feel weird saying the word disc, because are you selling
it's
hard
weird.
Copies of this? The
4-disc
anniversary edition is sharing things like outtakes and demos. And you're a very open person, right? You've spoken about your life very openly. You're very open in your writing. So I guess you're kind of used to it. But is it a special kind of feeling sharing maybe the most vulnerable versions of these songs that are already vulnerable songs, like the demos? Was that nervous for you, or was that kind of exciting to share those?
I decided to publish the entire first show, and it's embarrassing for me. I got to admit, it's kind of like having your high school photo where you have one eye shut and bad bangs and a bad outfit. It's having that photo talk for an hour.
Right.
Every darn thing that enters my head between songs, you hear it. I'm a kid, I'm 18, and you really hear it. But again, I wanted people to see where somebody starts, how you evolve. And so I was proud to do it, but it was a little bit cringeworthy.
I can understand that very much. And it's amazing how listening to the demos and the live versions, and you listen to the studio versions, those small little changes that got made along the way. And one of the ones that stood out for me is on You Were Meant For Me. And it's that in that opening guitar, the boo-da-doom-boo-da, you've got a bend. You've got a huge bend on one of those notes, but it's not on the album. Who chose that bend just didn't work? Was that a decision you made, or did somebody else tell you, I don't like that bend, take it out?
I wasn't confident in my guitar playing, and I had written that song with a friend. It's one of the few co-writes, a friend named Steve Poltz, who's he's from Halifax, a great treasure of a singer-songwriter. Everybody should look him up. The only studio stuff we did, I had him play guitar because I was just too nervous. I was at Neil Young's ranch with his band, the Stray Gators,
okay. And
I just was too nervous to do it. And so that's him. So I think it was just what mood he was in. If he was extra bouncy, he bent the string more. If he was more subdued and focused, it was less.
Yeah.
I never actually noticed.
Well, okay. Well, good. It's a good story anyway. The Foolish Games, obviously such a massive song for you, but also such a special music video. Because you've said so many times, you know, I'm a folk artist and I was trying to make it in the world of grunge. And for me, this video feels very grunge. So tell me about how the visuals match the lyrics and the experience on set for you.
You know, I was talking with David Grohl about punk rock and the definition of punk rock. And to me, punk rock is an unapologetic exhibition of who you are. It's bold. And for me, that's what I felt like. And it's interesting, like I always, you know, had the respect, oddly, of Metallica and David Grohl and Nirvana throughout my whole career. They really championed me and cheered me on, you know, whenever I'd see them. They're like, because I kind of had to do what I did was it took a lot of courage to say, I am sensitive at the height of grunge. It was like the anti-punk rock became the punk rock. It was a difficult thing to do.
You were always, you know, you say you were, you know, maybe a little lighter than some, but you always gave a badass vibe. You know, it's even if your songs were softer, there was always a part of your personality that felt like a fierce, strong person. I think that is kind of maybe what everyone's kind of seeing in that punk rock world and connecting with the fact that you are exactly who you are and you're unapologetic for that. And that is punk rock for sure.
Yeah, it was a great time. Everybody was trying to figure out, you know, how to be honest. And as you looked at what Nirvana did for the scene, we weren't a happy, shiny world. You know, there was glam rock before Nirvana, and they just came and let the whole world know we don't feel great. And you can say you don't feel great for so long until you kill yourself. I didn't want to kill myself. I wanted to figure it out. I wanted to figure out how to be happy. I was unhappy and I knew it. So all my music was sort of about, I feel pain, now what? And for me, that's what I was fighting for, was the now what, and yeah, what I continue to fight for.
And the now what, thankfully for us, in this upcoming year, we get a new album from you. So tell me a bit about what we can expect. What are you talking about on this album? Musically, is it a little bit different? Is it more folk? Is it more pop? Is it more... Tell me about it. I'm excited.
Thanks. This album is the first album I wrote from scratch, which sounds weird, but I've always had a huge back catalog, and I've just gone into my back catalog and chosen songs. I've never had to write a record. Maybe I'd write one song per record. But this thing I wanted to write from the ground up. And so they're all brand new songs. Nothing's older than a year. And it was a trip. I see why middle-aged artists do a lot of drugs to find a new sound, because it would have been easier than the archaeological shit show I had to do to like bring it out of myself.
Okay, so there was no ayahuasca or mushrooms for this album. Okay, I got it. Okay.
No, it was just all hard work of who am I now? What am I now? What interests me now? Where's the world at now? Because I am a singer-songwriter. I'm not looking for hits. I'm looking for an honest love letter to society and to myself. And so that's what the record is. It has more of a soul vibe. It's called Free Will and Woman, which took me about a year. I hate naming albums.
Did you have others that were close to being the name?
Oh my God. I had 5,000 names. That's why picking one, like I should almost pulled a Fiona Apple and was like, yeah, the driver wheel with the spark and the whip of the wilder.
I'm just going to suggest not doing that would be my one
I'm
tip
not doing
to you.
It.
Yeah. Okay, good. You have always handled yourself so well. You know, you've battled, you know, flashing lights and praise and fame and also, you know, the negative side of so many things. And in today's world, we're in a place where social media and reality TV or the 100 other ways to just make people feel really, really bad about themselves. And you seem to be able to come out of that so nicely and keep yourself so centered. And you've taken these ideas and these lessons that you've taught yourself and you've, you know, turned them into a foundation. You know, you've turned the Never Broken and the Inspiring Children's Foundation. So tell me about the time where you thought, I want to take those lessons and help other people. Why did you feel it important to not just heal yourself, but to share those lessons with people that needed it most?
An act of power is one that benefits you and your community. The work I do with my foundation and in helping other people with mental health tools was really birthed out of a goal of mine when I was 15. You know, I moved out at 15. I came from an abusive background, and I knew statistically kids like me end up repeating the cycle. And I didn't want to be a statistic. I knew happiness was not taught in my house. And did that mean that the rest of my life was doomed? Does that mean I never get to be happy? I don't want any human thinking that because they're isolated, because they don't have a loving family, because they don't have money, that happiness isn't for them. Happiness is for everybody. So now you have to develop tools that are going to start to take you on a new path. I call that mindfulness in motion. And that is what I really specialize in and really passionate about.
And so without giving the whole thing away, for people who are, you know, watching, listening, who maybe aren't able to be in, you know, in contact with the foundation or just, you know, don't know about ways to help themselves, what's the best piece of advice you can give someone to just help them maybe not get out of a dark place, but just help them get centered and be mindful of their own thoughts and their behaviors?
I think, first of all, just the knowledge of you can do it. you can do this. You can figure out how to make your life the way you want it if you're willing to put that work and focus and dedication in. So don't lose hope in that possibility. And then the quickest thing I would say is go to my website, jewelneverbroken.com. And that's where I took a lot of the tools and just created 3-minute exercises that anybody can practice at any age. It's what I use in the foundation to work with, you know, suicidal, highly anxietal kids. And they're simple. They're simple 3-minute exercises anybody can learn. So go to jewelneverbroken.com.
I just want to say thank you so much for not just talking to me today, but being so open about your life and open about the things that matter to you. And I'm so excited to hear your new album. I can't wait. Please make sure that you send me a streaming version so I can listen to it this afternoon. I can't wait. And that's it. Just thank you so much for being with us and giving us some of your time.
Thanks. It was nice to see you.
Really, really nice. You can hear Jewel all over Stingray Music. Make sure you download the Stingray Music app and search Jewel, J-E-W-E-L, to find all the channels that we play her on. Thank you again, Jewel, and we'll see you next time.